101.
Try to bring down to earth, just
truth and righteousness. We ask, Father, this morning that your people, God's people, the churches across this land, we pray for this nation. We pray for our president, his leadership. We pray, Father, for his guidance, Father, his cabinet. We just pray, God, that righteousness might be. We ask that you would break the teeth of the wicked, bring their plans to naught, to shame. We pray. We ask that the American people would examine the truth in light of what they're hearing today. We pray. In Jesus' name. Turn around and wave to your neighbor if you will.
I would.
And you may be seated. It's good to have you in services today. I know we're a little bit diminished from this whole COVID thing, but we pray that one day we'll get back to where we were. Trust that you see fellow members of your church, that you will invite them, you will call them, and just remind them that if they go to Walmart, Kmart, and any other mark, they can come to this mark, right? And have fellowship with God's people. And I believe that we're a pretty safe place to have fellowship around, and just a good place to be. In the way of announcements, if you haven't picked up your handout that's been provided by the Christ Seeker leaders, I encourage you to do that. They'd like you to fill out the survey, make it available to them. And if you would do that, we'd greatly appreciate copies of that on the back table in the back. And Christ Seekers will be starting September the 16th. We'll be here before you know it. I ask that you pray for your leaders. Pray for the boys and girls that will be coming. We're making this in-house right now. Because of this whole COVID thing, so that means all of our own people, we're not reaching out to the community like we normally want to do, but as far as being safe and all that business, that's what we're doing, that's what we agreed to do as leaders. And so we ask for our own boys and girls to be faithful and show up and come prepared, and there will be sanitizers and all that type of thing will be available. Be a little bit changed, we're going to start at 7 o'clock instead of 6:30, but boys and girls need to be studying under the instruction and teaching of the Word of God. They need that. And this whole COVID affair has not just affected you and I as adults, it's affected them as well. And so let's pray that we can have them there and be a part of that. September the 20th, Sheldon Rhodes will be with us with Goliath Spear. He will be ministering to us. He'll be coming in Saturday evening, setting up. You don't want to miss this. Man, I encourage you to be here. Invite your church family to be here for this. Never heard the man, never seen the man, but I know he has strong recommendations from Ken Ham. The Ark, you've heard about the Ark. He built the Ark and Creation Museum. He has strong recommendations from Ken Ham, so that's a pretty good endorsement. So we look forward to him. I think he comes from Battle Creek, and he's going to be down here with us Saturday evening, setting up Saturday evening. We'll have services Sunday morning. We look forward to that. And then Junior Church will be starting the end of September, September the 27th. So we're trying to get ourselves going again in the same way, using good common sense, and I think it's a good thing. Do we have any birthdays this morning?
What tomorrow's going to bring. Yes. Amen. That's what we're going to sing about. And sometimes we don't even know that we're going to sing about it, but we're here to sing about it today because God knows about it.
Don't know about tomorrow. about 10 minutes of that rainbow all day. I said, oh, what would heaven be like? If it's the glory of God and that rainbow, what is heaven going to be like? Oh, it's something I'll never forget. God's presence is in that rainbow. I love Him this morning. I want to do His will.
That God answers prayer.
speaking on that note, be sure to keep your brother, Brother Glenn, in prayer. He's in the hospital with Parkview, having issues with that infection with that leg of his. To keep Brother Steve, Steve is to hold him. He's having a baby. He's having a kidney stone. And I've heard stories, at least from the female side, compared that to having a baby. So I hope I never have it. Praise the Lord. I would just as soon be childless. When it comes to having a kidney stone, I pray for your brother, if you will, at this time. If you have your Bible this morning, I know you do. Take your Bible, turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. I don't really plan to be looking at this verse by verse, but we have been in this book three messages, four messages, I'm not sure now. And we've been looking at really what sets the stage for this book of Corinthians, at least the first letter. I think when you get into the second letter, these people, and considering all that Paul had done, talk about a bunch of ungrateful pups. He had been there for 18 months, ministering in this church, planting this church. And then when you get to the second letter he writes, they begin to question his apostleship. But I don't know that we're going to get to the second letter or not. But this 1 Corinthians, we want to look at just some high points along the way, not necessarily breaking it down verse by verse. But I want us to think this morning about faith that stands. And I think your faith and my faith ought to stand. We're living in pretty challenging times. I hope you're aware of that. I hear people say, well, I want America to get back to where America was. I don't know that America will get back to where it was. I pray that it does, and I pray that the church, if the church would do what the church is supposed to do, what the church signed up to do, America no doubt would get back to where it was. But if we don't do the things God tells us to do as a church, I think America's in some pretty difficult, dark days ahead. And I do believe that your faith and my faith is going to be tested. It's going to be challenged. What we read in magazines like Voice of the Martyrs and other magazines, maybe Friends of Israel magazine, possibly Bridges for Peace magazine, what we read of other people in other countries, other nations, what we've read of history past, maybe the Jewish people and Christians in days gone by, how they fled persecution in the motherland, wherever the motherland was for them. And they came to the United States and we could enjoy religious freedom. Those days that we've enjoyed this freedom could certainly be coming to an end. Pastor Jack Treiber pastors a church, a Baptist church in California. He has refused to succumb to the mandates of the state of California, refusing to come together to worship, refusing to sing. No, we're going to sing, and we're going to come together. Well, consequently, his church is being fined $50,000 a week by the county that he's in. John Maxwell is experiencing much the same thing. And so we are living in a time that is a very challenging time, and our faith is going to be tested. I am convinced, should the Lord tarry. I am convinced that should the Lord tarry and we possibly re-elect the president that holds to our Judeo-Christian values, we might hold off that persecution to some degree, but I want you to know there are voices out there. Protests that are being planned in various cities around the United States, they're very adamant about bringing down white rulership. And we're not saying white rulership, black rulership. We're not advocating racism. But their whole mandate is, they call it just white rulership. And they talk about this Christian values that we hope to. They want to bring that down as well. So they're protesting those things. So the Christian is in the crosshair. And at some point in time, I am convinced that you and I, should the Lord tarry, and I don't think necessarily particularly a very long time, we're finding it in states around the United States. For like example, the state of California, the state of Nevada, the state of West Virginia, and New York. The faith of Christians is being put to the test, and if you exercise your liberty under the First Amendment as a believer in Jesus Christ, these governors in these states and mayors in these states have chosen to use their power, contrary to the Constitution of the United States, to assert their will. And they are directing their anger against particularly the person of Jesus Christ. If you go back and read your Bible, in the book of Romans chapter 1, they don't want nothing to do with the name of Jesus Christ, the God of heaven. You go back and read the book of 2 Peter chapter 2, they don't want nothing to do with the God of heaven, and they're bringing in a doctrine called the doctrine of apostasy. I encourage you to go home and read the second chapter of 2 Peter. And don't read it as if you're reading something that happened a long, long time ago. When you read it as if it's on the front page of the news today. And you will be amazed at what you read in that chapter, how it's being played out. Might show up next Sunday morning in the message, you don't know. But how it will play, how it's playing out today. The players are playing their parts. And the Lord says in that chapter about these that are exercising their ungodliness. He calls them brute beasts. Brute beasts. Animals. The kind of animals that ought to be removed and destroyed. I'm not talking about revolt, but he compares those kind of wicked people and the times in which these people manifest their power and their influence upon the world and upon the nation and upon God's people. He compares them to wicked, savage beasts. That's exactly what you're experiencing today. And I believe that as early as late November, we could be feeling the strong effect of this wickedness. That's why the Bible tells us in the Word to pray that the enemies of righteousness pray that God would break their teeth. Doesn't the Lord use some amazing descriptions about wicked people and how he sees their influence and their rulership destroyed? He said, break their teeth. You break their teeth, you don't want to talk too much, you know, do you? And that's how he admonishes God's people to pray that their rulership, their ability to influence. Well, Paul is teaching here in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and 2. He's really teaching about this wisdom that's out there in the world because the Corinthians gravitated toward it. It really caught their attention, and they were greatly enamored by it. And he is admonishing us that the wisdom of the world is not what you want to listen to. You need to listen to the preaching and the teaching of the cross because it will solve your problems. It will fix your life. It will fix your home. It will fix what's wrong with you and I personally, spiritually. It's called a sin problem. And it will fix that if we'll look to it and take its message and apply its message to our life. Let's read, if we may, the first five verses of 1 Corinthians chapter 2. It says this, and I, brethren, when I came to you, I came not with excellence of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you, save Jesus Christ and him crucified. Paul was, he was focused, wasn't he? He was fixed upon one thing, preaching Jesus Christ. Why is that? Well, because Jesus Christ fixed the Apostle Paul. And there's some of you here today, I hope all of you can give testimony to the fact that the Lord has fixed what's wrong with you. And he's still working on you, isn't he? He works on you every day, does he not? How does he do it? He does it through the work of the Holy Spirit. He works on you. And he corrects that which is wrong within you. And you do that as you come under the teaching, preaching, and the instruction from the Word of God. And it says in verse 3, and I was with you in weakness and fear and much trembling, and my speech and my preaching was not with the enticing words of men's wisdom. But listen to this, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power. How important is the demonstration of the Spirit and the power within our church and in our life? I would say it's very important. Notice what says verse 5. It says that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men. You remember in previous messages how this church was impressed by various preachers. They had a sickness called preacheritis. Now, there's nothing wrong with having your favorite teacher or your favorite preacher or your favorite ways of teaching and presenting the word. There's nothing wrong with that. But when that person becomes your idol, when you look to that person, you close the doors to any other gospel, faithful teaching preacher, then you've got an idol that's in the person of a man. My former pastor always used to say, never get your eyes upon a man. Why is that? Because their feet are made of clay. He said, Paul said, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. You know, it's not hard to find people who say they have faith. But it's a lot harder to find people whose faith stands. Notice it says, in the power of God. You know, when you study this book of Corinthians, there was a lot of problems within this church. One writer said of this church, and I think I mentioned it to you last time, he said of this church that it was a scandalous church because of all the things. If you read and study this book, because of all the kinds of problems that this church had, if you just read through this book and study this book a little bit, you'll be absolutely shocked. How could these people actually call themselves church? But they had turned from the instruction of the preaching of the cross. They gravitated toward that which was the wisdom of this world. That's what moved the needle in their heart. They thought that the more of the wisdom of this world that they could get behind the pulpit, if you will, that would solve their problem. Wrong answer. When you look at this church and the problems that they had within this church, they had problems with moral issues, they had sexual issues, they had doctrinal issues, they had problems with, can you believe this, with incest was in this church, and yet this church did absolutely nothing about it. They just marched on as if there was nothing was wrong. You see, clearly they were not sitting under the teaching and the preaching and the ministry of the cross, because the preaching of the cross says we don't do those things. We live a different kind of a life because of the preaching of the cross. And the preaching of the cross, when we listen to the preaching of the cross and we apply its message to our life, it fixes our life, it fixes our home, it fixes our marriage, it fixes what's wrong with us. When we'll take the preaching and the teaching of this book, of this Bible, you know, this Bible tells us the message of the coming of Jesus Christ, doesn't it? We turn to the Old Testament. I've heard men say, you know, well, we're New Testament Christians, and we are New Testament Christians. But they discourage the study of the Old Testament. Well, you know, when I hear a man say something like that, I don't think that man's not the brightest light in the harbor, you know? I think he's a few bricks short of a full pallet, because he's never studied his Bible very thoroughly. Because the Bible in the Old Testament is telling us about the Christ that is to come in the New Testament. You know that? When you read your Bible, the Bible of the Old Testament is just as much inspired as the Bible of the New Testament. Verbally inspired Word of God. And from that instruction from the Word of God, we learn of the coming of Jesus Christ and the cross that he was going to die upon. And in this great, great book that we have this morning that we read from and that we study from, and I hope you have devotions every day from, in this great, great book, it deals what's wrong with me. I have a lot of things wrong with me. I would imagine you have a few things wrong with you if you're part of the human race. But if you open this book and read this book, you know the amazing thing about this book, it will speak to you.
Amen.
Close it up. Open it up. And it will speak to you. It will speak to your heart. It will minister to your soul. Now, if you've ever been to the ocean, and I'm told that even in the Great Lakes, they have to deal with something called riptide. You ever heard of riptide? Riptide is an undercurrent that will take you away from the shore and pull you up, maybe even possibly pull you down, I don't know. But in any event, it's a dangerous thing. And I want you to know this morning there's a riptide taking place in the world this morning, and that's the riptide of the old devil. The old devil himself is doing everything in his power to draw us away from the preaching of the cross. He's doing everything in his power to keep the church out of church. Men and women who profess faith in Jesus Christ, men and women who took a walk down the aisle, professed faith in Jesus Christ and united themselves with the church and followed the Lord and believers' baptism. The devil's doing everything in his power with his satanic riptide to draw them away, to keep them from being where they need to be so they can have their families nourished under the teaching and preaching of the Word of God. So they can be in a church that has a Christ seeker, that's concerned about the ministry of boys and girls. So they can be in a church that has a junior church, that's concerned about the ministry of boys and girls. Yes, we might be in a pandemic, but praise the Lord, we got a governor in our United States, in the state of Ohio, that says he encourages churches to come together. I praise the Lord for that, don't you? Amen? We ought to pray for our governor. Thank the Lord for our governor. What if we had the governor of California? What if you had the governor of the state of Michigan?
Oh. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Then we got a person back. Pray for them. They need a lot of help, I'm telling you. They need a lot of help. Let me tell you something. I praise the Lord that our government recognizes the place of the church, and the church has a right to come together and worship the Lord and worship and pray. praise the Lord and singing to the Lord. I praise the Lord for that. But listen, there's an undercurrent in thinking and reasoning in the church today that only the wisdom of the world can solve its problems. Well, what does Paul say to that? Well, in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 19, he says this. He says, for the wisdom of this world is what? Is foolishness with God. Read what the rest of the verse says. It is foolishness with God. For it is written, he takes the wise in their own craftiness. There are men today that are out propagating their doctrine. They're telling you what's wrong with this party, and they're telling you what's wrong with that party. But I want you to know that you and I would be a wise man and a wise woman if we just take this book and read what's wrong with me. If I can just get me fixed before God, that's going to fix a whole lot of things right in this world. I'd like to take dear old Kamala Harris and let her send her to the teaching and preaching the Word of God, wouldn't you?
Amen.
I'd like to take Mr. Joe Biden and send him under the teaching and preaching, and our President, President Trump, and send him under the preaching of the Word of God, because that's going to solve our problems. If you can fix what's wrong with the heart, you'll fix what's wrong with man. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 1:20, God made foolish the wisdom of this world. I was reading this past week as I was studying on this passage of Scripture that someone was critical of D.L. Moody and they criticized his style of preaching. They said he was unsophisticated. He didn't preach in a sophisticated manner. He preached like a common man speaking to common people. D.L. Moody responded by saying this, I have been called to feed sheep, not giraffes. I have been called to put the cookies on the bottom shelf where the children sit, where they can reach those cookies. Moody was saying that when he preached to feed sheep, not to fill men's heads with fluff. Moody said that when he preached to feed the children. He didn't come to impress your cranial cavity up here. He came to speak in such a way that would speak to your heart. When you examine, if you've ever read any messages by Moody, he preached a simple message. He preached and told us about the wages of sin. And isn't that the preaching of the cross this morning? It tells us about the wages of sin. There wouldn't be a cross if there wasn't no sin, right? But because there was sin, Jesus Christ came and he died upon the cross for sins. I mean, what happens in this simple preaching, the preaching of the cross? We've said to you in previous messages, we get a new character. We become a new person in Jesus Christ. And then we said the preaching of the cross does something else in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 25. Look what it says here. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than man. What happens when we preach the cross? What happens when we apply the message of the cross? We get a new wisdom of how to live life. We learn how to treat our husband. We learn how to treat our wife. We learn how to treat our employer. You see, that comes from God, from God's Word. That's where it comes from. It comes from God's Word. We get a new wisdom. We not only get a new wisdom and a new character, but we get something else. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 16. It says, for who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. What is that saying? Listen, when we preach the cross and we apply the message of the cross to your life and my life, we get something else that's new. We get a new one-two. We get a new one-two. We get a new one-two to want to serve the Lord and let the Lord solve our problems by seeking him in his word. Well, these Corinthians were a carnal bunch. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, look what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, as unto babes in Christ. This carnal church tried to solve the problems with the wisdom of this world, and they were missing out on a very, very important ingredient they needed to preach, the cross. And the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 19, dealing with their problems, he said, but he taketh the wise in their own craftiness. What does that mean? That means their problems continue. Now, you stop and think about this. How are we to preach? What is the right way to preach? Well, I got to thinking about that and studying in my study, and I don't know where I came across it, but I was reading something the other day, and we talked about this Orthodox church, Greek Orthodox, I think that's what it was. And then I got to doing some reference work, and I found, well, some other church called themselves Unorthodox Church. And what is Orthodox? Is Orthodox a good thing? Well, it's a big word. What does it mean? Are we orthodox? Do we have values that we can say are orthodox? What do we mean when we say orthodox? When we say we preach what we hold to, what we believe in. We preach on the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. These are things that the Bible clearly teaches, and we teach and preach, and we are very orthodoxy in it, in that we believe it, we hold to it with all of our heart. It's telling us the fundamentals of the Word of God. Now, we say the word we. But just because we say we, does that make it right? Does that make it right? You know, there's a lot of churches out there that say they preach that they're orthodox. They preach this orthodox doctrine. But when you examine what they hold to, what they believe in, and hold it up to what the Word of God has to say, well, then in the light of the Word of God, then they are not truly orthodox, because they have clearly been pulled away by a spiritual riptide, if you will, that like we were talking about earlier. Listen, we can be sincere, but we can be sincerely wrong. There's a lot that are sincere about their worship, about their beliefs, but when held up to the Word of God, it's wrong. Because why? Because the Bible teaches us there's one God.
Amen.
There's one Savior. There's one way of salvation. There's one Word of God, and there's one gospel. And if your church teaches anything other than that, then it's not truly orthodox. You know, preaching ought to be orthodox. We believe in the virgin birth, do we not? Virgin birth is important to the gospel, is it not? Listen, Jesus wasn't born, wasn't fathered by his earthly father. He was fathered by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit conceived in the womb of Mary. And so all that was in the person of Jesus Christ was divine. Amen? He was divine. If it weren't divine, then he couldn't have went to the cross and died for our sins. If he had an Adamic nature like you and I have, if he would have went to the cross and died, he would have just went there and died, but he would have never been able to pay the price for your sin and my sin. He had to be God in the body of flesh, but he had to be all God, 100% God, who put on our body of flesh. So we preach the virgin birth. We believe these things. We hold to these things. Not because some man declares that we should. We believe them because the Bible says we should believe them. That's what the Bible teaches us we should do. But as I was reading in my Bible, doing some study upon that, I came across something that just sparked my thinking. Bear in mind what we read here in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 5. It says that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Back up to verse 4 in chapter 2. He says, and my speech and my preaching was not with the enticing words of men's wisdom, but listen to this, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and with power. The demonstration of the Spirit and with power. Do you know this morning we can preach the right things, say the right things, be sincere about preaching the right things, but if we don't have the demonstration of the Spirit, and if we don't have power, that which we're preaching won't account for much. You realize that? Let me show you something. Go with me back to the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And as we go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, let's just pick it up in verse 2. Now, Paul is admonishing these people that they were epistles. They were planted in the heart of the city of Corinth. They were placed in a place that was a hellhole. It was a wicked place. They were placed like going into the factory, the office that you go into. They were placed in a place like some of your schools that you go to. Do we have anybody who goes to Eaton here this morning? Do we have anybody who goes to Montpelier this morning? Anybody goes to North Central? Anybody goes to Bryan? All right, we got people who go to Bryan, Montpelier, wherever. Listen, those places can be little hellholes. You hear people say bad things, do bad things, tell bad stories. And you and I find ourselves, well, I don't find myself there anymore, but our boys and girls do, find themselves planted there because you've got to get an education. Listen to what the Apostle Paul is saying to his boys and girls and moms and dads, because it's speaking to all of us. You are epistles. What's an epistle? Well, we read a letter here in the Word of God. It's called the epistle to the Galatians, the epistle to the Ephesians. It's a letter. But he compares your life, my life, to a letter. And what do you do with a letter? Well, you read it, don't you? You take a letter, you open it up, you open the Apostle Paul is telling us, that the lives that we live, the places that we go, the places that we have been placed to work, whether we're in school, going to school, getting education, whether we're on the ball team, playing basketball, football, baseball, whatever we're doing, or in the office, or wherever we're at, the Bible says we're epistles. Whether we realize it or not, somebody is reading the pages of your life and my life. Listen to what it says. Verse 2, 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Ye are epistles written in our hearts, known and read of all men. That means the bad guys, the bad girls, the good guys, the good girls, the teachers that we are around the school. That means the bosses that we hang around. That means the people, our foremen and so forth. They're reading the pages of your life. What do they see in your life? Does the gospel make a difference in your life? Has the gospel impacted your life? Has it impacted your choices? Has it impacted your home? Has it impacted your marriage? It should. Apply its principles to your life, and it will change you. But listen, what he says, for as much as ye are manifestly declared to be epistles of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in the fleshly tables of hearts. Because an application to the Ten Commandments that were written with the finger of God back at Sinai, given to Moses, called the Ten Commandments, and he uses your life, my life, and he calls it an epistle, and it's written, there is the finger of God has written upon your life, my life, by our actions, by the words we say, the habits that we have, the faithfulness that we demonstrate, by coming to church on Sunday morning, because your neighbors know you're a Christian, or at least know you have some kind of church affiliation, by your faithfulness to the church you attend every Sunday. Whether they say anything or not, they see your car pulling out of the driveway. They know where you're going. You don't have to tell them where you're going. That's the tip. But they know you're going to church because you are a religious person. That's how they say it. You got religion. But they're reading the pages of your life. You're an epistle. And the finger of God has written upon your heart the conviction of heart that says, I need to be up. I need to get my kids around. Oh, it's not easy getting my kids around. It would be so much easier to stay home and have virtual church. There's a time and place for all things, amen? But if you're healthy and able to get out of bed, get your caboose out of bed, get dressed, come to church, have fellowship with God's people, sing the hymns of the faith, give your tithe as you ought to do, as unto the Lord, when you walk out the back door on that offering table. These are things that we do. Why? Because the finger of God has wrote upon my heart the conviction of heart. This comes because of the preaching of the cross. This is not, we're telling you to do this in Bethlehem. We're telling you what the Word of God says we ought to do. And because we're Christians, we just happen to have a denominational name. Because we're Christians, we do the right thing. Amen. We do it when we go to school. Kids want you to join in with a bunch. Or maybe girls want you to join in and do this or do that, say this, say that. We do the right thing. Why? Because the finger of God has wrote in my heart the difference between right and wrong. And I learn about that in the Word of God. Now listen to what he says. Verse 5. Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. Now look what he says, verse 6. We're talking about being, what's the word we began with? Orthodoxy. Can you say the word orthodoxy?
Orthodoxy.
Orthodoxy is what we hold to and believe in, right? We preach the virgin birth. We preach the any moment return of Jesus Christ. I was thinking this morning when I got up this morning, wouldn't it be a great day for the Lord to return today? Hallelujah. Yeah. We could skip out on early ballots. We could skip out on November election. I get so sick and tired of hearing about COVID and vaccines and I get so sick of hearing it. All it does is fire me up. Wouldn't you like to have the Lord come today? Would it mess up your plans if he came today? Would you be unhappy if you couldn't go home and have chicken? Can I grab that chicken as I go, Lord? Would you be unhappy? Oh, listen, I tell you, he's got a whole chicken pen in heaven, I guarantee you. We believe in orthodoxy. We hold to these truths, and we teach these truths. They're so important that they need to be taught. Our boys and girls need to be taught about the rapture of the church and the revelation. The rapture is when he comes for the church, the revelation when he comes at the end of the tribulation. Our boys and girls need to be taught all of that good stuff. Why do we have that good stuff? Because that's the preaching of the cross. Yeah. It began back in the book of Genesis chapter 1, and it will culminate at the end of the book of Revelation. That's the preaching of the cross. And we need teachers who will teach it. Who have a burden to teach it. Who have a burden to pass it on. What's that song? Passing the faith along to my brother. Passing the faith along. Giving a word of hope, something like that, to my brother. That's what we need to do. That's what we're called to do. But oh, the devil wants to pull you out of the riptide. He wants you to sit out here and tread water. He wants you to think only about yourself. I don't want to die thinking only about myself, do you? I want to leave a legacy, don't you? I want a church that's still living and vibrant and productive after I'm gone, don't you? Well, it ain't going to get there when we're just sitting on our blessed assurance doing nothing. Listen, we can preach orthodoxy until the cows come home. Look what he says in verse 6. Who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. Did you know that you could preach orthodoxy all day long and be right? But if you don't have the blessing, if you don't have the unction, if you don't have the fullness of the Holy Spirit upon your teaching, upon your preaching, upon the ministry in your church can still dry up and wither up and die. You need the Spirit. And that's what Paul says back in the book of 1 Corinthians. He said that your faith, verse 5, chapter 2, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Paul describes his preaching and how he preached and how why he got results. He had the Spirit's anointing. He had the Spirit's anointing. You realize the letter can kill. It's the Spirit that gives life to our words. You can say the right thing, speak the truth from your heart that's sincere, but without the Spirit's quickening, without the Holy Spirit's unction upon the heart, we're not going to get a harvest. We're not going to get a harvest of lost. We're not going to get a harvest of backslidden coming home. We're not going to see positive growth. The Holy Spirit takes orthodoxy, takes it out of the clouds, puts feet in the giraffes, and puts the cookies on the bottom shelf. Has your moms and dads ever made you cookies, boys and girls? Made cookies? And they just know what you do when you come home from school. You smell those chocolate chip. Monster cookies? You like monster cookies? You like monster cookies? They are good. And you smell those cookies when you walk in the door coming home from school, don't you? How many like cookies? Tyler, you like cookies? Oh, yeah. You like them when Christmas? What's your favorite cookie, Tyler?
Peanut butter.
Peanut butter. Oh, yes. Man's got good taste. Good taste. When you come in from being outside, maybe it's been out and you've been out in the cold, and you're feeling a little bit of a sugar drainage from your body, and oh, how you would like a cup of good coffee or maybe a glass of milk and some of the crystals, peanut butter, cookies. That would just get you through the rest of the day now, wouldn't it? Just give you the strength to make it the rest of the way. Absolutely. I don't know where I was going with that. But somewhere. Oh, yeah. Orthodoxy. Paul said, I don't preach putting this stuff on the top shelf. I put the cookies on the bottom shelf. What does he say? He says, I make it as simple as I can possibly make it. Why do I make it as simple as I possibly can make it that way? It's because I want people to understand it. Well, then, what is the power of the Holy Spirit? What is this unction that we've heard about, preachers preach about and talk about, of days gone by? It sounds like a mystery to me. Let me tell you what the unction is. Let me tell you what the power of the Holy Spirit is. I think there's a lot of preachers. I think there's a lot of churches. I think there's a lot of ministries that don't experience it. They experience orthodoxy, but they never experience that anointing of the Holy Ghost upon their life, upon their preaching, upon their teaching. It's when the supernatural comes down. when the supernatural power of Almighty God takes and touches the few fish and the little bit of bread, and he begins to multiply it. And he feeds a multitude with a little bit of nothing. There's an old song that says, little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name. Yes, we need to be orthodoxy. Yes, we need to preach the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help me God. But as we go, we need to have the unction of the Holy Spirit. How do we get this unction of the Holy Spirit? Oh, we get it when we go to school. We get it when we get a degree. We get it when we sit under theological classes. No, those things are good in and of themselves. But the Bible tells us that we get it. And when you go back and read these great men of the faith, they get it as they pray. What unleashes the Spirit of the Holy Spirit in our church? What invites the Holy Spirit to our services and to the preacher's work? The preacher who prays puts God into the work. God's Spirit doesn't come to the preacher's work and the preacher's teaching just because he's preaching. He comes because he's earnestly praying before the God of heaven. Oh, it's not a little short little one-liner that says, Lord, Lord, help me today because I'm going to stand up here and preach those Bethlehem Christian Unionites. Oh, no. You see, that's praying like a Pharisee. I like to call the Pharisees the Pharisees. The Pharisees used to stand and pray long prayers, but the only time they stood and prayed long prayers was when people were watching them or listening to them. You want the power of the Holy Spirit? Then you need a burden upon your heart that says, you know what, this message is so important. I want these people to get this message. Lord, this message is so important. Lord, I'm the bread of weakness. I'm the few fish. I have no ability in and of myself. I have a message that's orthodoxy, but unless the Holy Spirit anoints that message, it will not put the cookies on the bottom shelf. So men and women can understand it and lay hold of it and eat it and digest it and grow because of it. When the unction of the Holy Spirit comes upon us, Paul says, chapter 2, verse 5, 1 Corinthians, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men. You'll not stand in the hour of testing. You'll not stand in the hour of battle unless you have the unction of the Holy Spirit. You might have orthodoxy running out your ears, letters upon top of letters of theological classes that you have passed and got degrees from. But that's not the power of the Holy Spirit. The power of the Holy Spirit is not just for preachers. The power of the Holy Spirit is for every one of us. We can have that power as we pray before the Lord daily. Churches need to pray for their pastors. Daily. And I've been double dog met across this congregation. Probably many of you have not prayed daily for the ministry of this pulpit. Oh, you prayed for your family. We're a praying church. You prayed for your family, but you never prayed for the pulpit. You never prayed for the ministry of this church. We need to pray for this church daily. Lord, bless my man. Now, I'm not talking about kindergarten. How long have you been saved? Well, I've been saved. Let's see, 10, 20, 30. Well, I've been saved for a long time. And you ought to pray like you've been saved for a long time. Amen. You ought to pray like you've been saved for a long time. You ought to pray like you've had fellowship with God Almighty. Amen. Leave that legacy. And pour out your heart before God because you're so burdened about the success of your church, the future of your church, the preaching that comes forth from the pulpit, because you're burdened about your grandchildren, your children being edified, built up, and having the opportunity to be saved, and that the Holy Spirit would come upon their heart and begin to convict their heart of their sinfulness, that they need a Savior. They go to school all week long. They're surrounded with a bunch of people that don't know the Lord. I told you a couple weeks ago, your house, you can get dust pretty easy in your house, can't you? It just happens. And sometimes the house has to be dusted. We can get dust in our soul, worldly dust. And what it does, it tends to make us indifferent, spiritually hardened. And the world that I came out of as a machinist, we heard a term about being case hardened. They're just right on the surface. Maybe a few tents, but there's hardness on the surface of that metal. Christians born-again, orthodox, fundamental, Bible-believing, God-fearing Christians live all week in the world. They show up in church on Sunday morning. Your boys and girls do, just like you. And there's a bit of hardness on their soul. And the only way that hardness is going to be removed is if we prevail in prayer with moms and dads, and grandpas, and grandmas, for our babies, for their soul, and for the preaching of the word through your Sunday school teacher, through your preaching, that when that word goes out, it's like a hot air. It doesn't bounce off my arm. No, it penetrates. It's my heart. Why does it hit my heart? Because the power of the Holy Spirit has been at work. Now notice what Paul says. 1 Corinthians 2:5, we'll wrap this up. That your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. What does your faith stand? I think Paul foreseen our great falling away to come. He foreseen a great day to come that the church was going to be tested like never before. I ask you a question this morning. When the storms of life come, will your anchor hold? The cross and the preaching of the cross is where the wounds caused by our sin is healed. I'm thankful for that this morning. I'm thankful that this is a church that preaches the message of the cross, but is also a church that recognizes the need for the power of the Holy Spirit to bless that message. I trust this morning that the Holy Spirit has spoken to your heart. Maybe boys and girls of my Holy Spirit might have spoken to your heart this morning. Convicted you about your life. Convicted you of any of the words that you've used to school. Or moms and dads. Things that we've said. Things we've thought. The problems that we are experiencing oftentimes is because we have departed from the wisdom of this book. And we have listened to the wisdom of our flesh. And because we've listened to the wisdom of our flesh, we're finding ourselves now experiencing a spiritual riptide, pulling us away from the face of the Lord. And I want you to know this morning, the Lord loves us. He wants you to come back to Him. He wants you to have full fellowship with Him. And if you're here this morning, don't know you're your Lord and Savior. He wants you to be saved today. That can happen today. Simply as you surrender yourself. You say, well, you know, Pastor, that's the wrong way down that aisle. You know what? You just take the first step. My former pastor used to say, well, you need grace to take the next, to the next, to the next. And there are people I would love to show you how to be saved. If you're not saved. Or maybe you just need to rededicate yourself as a Christian. That old world, man, I tell you, it beats you up. You ever have those weeks? He's just like the old devil jumps on you. He's got you down. He's hitting you with slobber knockers all week long. Come to church dragging yourself in like some old roadkill on the road to church. You say, Lord, I need something. We've got something this morning. Lord, it's for you. The best way to fix your problems is on your knees before the Lord. Let God have His will in your life. If you keep trying to fix them, you'll be just like those old Corinthians. You'll be just like those old Corinthians were. You will get blessed because you're trusting the wisdom of grace. Who's inspiring this prison? Give it better. But who's inspiring you to get your life right with the Lord? It's the Holy Spirit. Let's all stand. Father, we thank you for the word this morning. We believe this morning, Father, there are those today who need to make decisions for Jesus Christ. We pray you have your will in this invitation. May we do that which you'd have us to do, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. With heads bowed and eyes closed, the instruments playing. If the Spirit of the living God has spoke to your heart today about your relationship with the Lord, your walk with the Lord, maybe you need to come to the altar. Yes, you can make that decision with the people I understand. Sometimes the Lord wants us to step out. Sometimes the voice is calling us. We need to use that altar. We get on our knees before Him and say, Lord, I want you to have your way in my life. I want you to be first. I don't want you to be second. I want you to be first in my life. And I surrender all to you. Maybe you need to come and just say, Lord, I surrender. I surrender my all to you today. If the Lord is speaking to your heart, that